Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to be chairing the session. It's really an amazing conference that Sergio and I know Aureo and Alejandro and other collaborators put together. So it's really, I think, from the perspective of Brazilian labor market and informality, it's as good as it could get, both in terms of academic and policy content. So I'm super thrilled to be here. And above all, to be introducing this session. So we're gonna have three presentations, and David Card, Lorenzo Lagos, and Sergio. So I have a personal connection with Sergio, a colleague since the master's in PUC Rio. I was a committee member of Lorenzo in Colombia. So I have a colleague, I have a former student, and David Card was never directly my professor, but I guess he was a professor of all of us, right? So I'm going to introduce each speaker at a time. I think Professor Card is going to talk for less than an hour, so we're going to have some time for questions. And then after that, I introduce Lorenzo and Sergio more properly. So Professor David Card is the class of 1950, professor of economics at Berkeley, where he has been for over 20 years now. I think everybody knows he's the Nobel Prize winner in 2021, but on top of that, he received all major awards in the economics profession, including the Fritsch Medal, the Clark Medal, the Mincer Award. He's a fellow of the National Academy of Sciences. But I think even this list, this is just really a very small sample of the list, even this list really doesn't do justice to the influence that he has had in the economics profession, right? Both from a methodological and policy perspective. So methodologically, he's been one of the pillars of the so-called the credibility revolution in economics over the last 30 or 40 years. And topic-wise, he has really developed some seminal work on minimum wages, monopsony power in the labor market, returns to education and training, immigration, racial wage gaps, unions. All of these are topics that today, I guess, are particularly relevant. And he has made seminal contributions to all of these topics. So it's really impossible to exaggerate the influence that he has had in the economics profession more generally, in applied microeconomics, and in labor economics in particular. For me, it's a special pleasure because I've seen Professor Card talking many times. I actually never met him personally, even though I know I have several former students who are advised by him, who work for him. So it's indirectly, I feel like I almost know him through Edson Severnini and Daniel Rowinco and Sergio and Gustavo Gonzaga. So it's really a special pleasure. So please join me in welcoming Professor Card, and let's get it started. Please.
Well, thank you, Rodrigo, for that overly generous introduction. That's too bad my mom wasn't here. So I'm going to give just an overview of the kind of a personal overview of the origin and general state on the idea of firm wage setting, and I should apologize for having missed most of Penny's talk this morning. But I don't have much to say about informality, but I'll try and at least open up some of the questions that I think are interesting in this somewhat related area of firm wage setting. So I think it's a little bit hard. These days there's a lot of interest in the topic of wage setting, but that really is a very modern development. In some ways, what's happened recently is kind of a foreshadowing or a replay of what happened in the 1930s. So in 1932, John Hicks, the famous economist who later on wrote Value and Capital, wrote his first famous book, which was called The Theory of Wages. And in that book, he laid out the kind of the working model that labor economists have been using ever since then, with competitive firms, perfectly competitive on the output side, and competitive labor markets. Interestingly enough, just a year later, Joan Robinson wrote her book, and Chamberlain wrote his book. And those two books were important in economics because they, actually it's kind of hard to imagine this, but they discovered the idea of a marginal revenue curve. So before that, people hadn't really completely understood that. And Robinson, in writing down the marginal revenue curve for selling, realized there was a similar kind of curve for buying, which I always call the marginal factor cost curve. And that led her to introduce the concept of monopsony. And I did have a one day in 1993, Alan Manning was visiting Princeton. And I got the idea, I said, Alan, we should write a letter to this guy who Joan Robinson credited with inventing the word monopsony and see, like, because I looked him up and he was still alive. And he wrote me back a really nice letter, very detailed about the origin of the word and all the difficulty he had finding a word that sounded good and actually meant something in Greek. And I guess for that kind of a scholar, it's important that, you know, to him, monopsony sounded good, and the alternatives didn't sound as good. But it turns out that monopsony is largely about selling fish. So, okay. So what happened after, in the 1930s, was I think that was a period of great turmoil, partially because of the Great Depression, partially because of a lot of actually pretty deep ideological discussions about market systems versus non-market systems, because at that time Soviet Union was making a play for a lot of influence. And Lloyd Reynolds, another famous labor economist, wrote a paper in the American Economic Review in 1946 in which he said the words I've just quoted here, that this idea of an upward sloping supply curve seems to be making a lot of headway. And in his paper, he talked a little bit about different reasons for the upward sloping supply curve, which are more or less the same ones I'm going to be talking about later on today. But by the time we get to the 1960s, that monopsony was relegated to the minor leagues, is the way I would put it. And so what I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk a little bit about how that got reversed, or reversed and reversed. I want to make sure that everybody realizes that this same thing happened in price setting in the IO side, probably starting around 1980. When I was an undergraduate in the 70s, it was very common for people to basically ignore the idea of monopoly or monopoly wage setting, price setting power, except for natural monopolies like utilities and so on. And we were all taught a famous paper by Arnold Harberger saying that, okay, there's a little bit of monopoly power in the labor in the U.S. economy, but it really is kind of third order. So what's happened, I think, in labor is like a 30-year lag on what happened in I.O. And so driving this sort of recognition about the importance of thinking about how wages are set, I think it's really three factors. One is finally, you know, labor economists discover the 70s. So we kind of finally are starting to take search theoretic type models and differentiated product models a little bit more seriously. There's a lot of new data sources, administrative data, data sets like the HICE, which have been, you know, very important in establishing facts about the labor market and showing the importance of firm-specific factors driving wage setting. And then there's a third part, which is more design-based. I would say a lot of the stuff that in this second point is sort of descriptive material. There's a little bit more interesting design-based research showing things like what happens. A very interesting recent paper looking at a pharmacy chain in Brazil, two pharmacy chains in Brazil which merged, and an analysis that I'll mention briefly, where it looked like there was actually some impact of that on the labor market. So why didn't monopsony catch on the first time? Well, one reason was that the analysis that's done, and the analysis is still in the textbooks, is very, 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 very simple. So there's basically a perfect monopsony, single firm, upward sloping supply curve. There's no strategic interactions, and there's no real way to say, how should I think about this supply curve to this firm as related to what other firms are doing? So if you, for the last few years, I've been doing some consulting in the tech sector, and if you're helping tech sector companies set wages, there's nothing really you can do with that model. It doesn't really say where you get those parameters or anything like that. Related to that, both Robinson and Chamberlain used a graphical approach. They didn't really have equations very much in their papers. And one of the most famous critics of both of them, George Stigler, who was probably very deeply ideologically opposed to the idea of market power in those markets, basically criticized their models because he said that they didn't really have any useful empirical predictions. And that was an easy case to make, but then in the 1970s, first Michael Spence and then Dixit and Stiglitz wrote down these infinite number of product CES functions, and that allowed us to have a formalization of the Chamberlainian idea that there's price setting power by individual firms in the monopolistic competition model that Chamberlain had in mind fits exactly into that framework. So the individual firm has some price setting power, but it doesn't take account of its choices or the choices in any strategic way. So that what happened then within a few years, those kind of models became the go-to models in a lot of different fields, like international trade, and some extent like Blanchard Kiyotaki's famous macro paper is a version of this. So that really had a lot of influence outside of labor economics, but no one really thought about how to think about that in a labor economics setting. A third factor that's kind of important to keep in mind is that in almost all monopsony models, firms are labor starved. So most of those models have the characteristic that if a worker were to present themselves at the door of the firm and say, I'll take a job, I'm equally qualified to everybody you've got, and I'll work for the same wage that they're getting paid, that the firm would be willing to hire them. Some models don't quite have that, but a lot of them have that flavor, and that's gonna be a hard sell in the middle of a depression, because people, I think, found that idea inconsistent with what they saw around them. And to some extent, I think that's still an important thing to keep in mind, is it might not be that you wanna have a monopsonistic type model in every labor market. For instance, in a labor market where the minimum wage is extremely high, some parts of Brazil, northeastern Brazil or something, you might say, well, almost everybody at the low end of the labor market is basically getting paid the minimum wage, so we shouldn't worry so much about wage setting power. And then a fourth thing that happened, I think, is, I've already sort of mentioned this, in the 1930s and then after the Cold War, there was a lot of economics which was really very much like trying to defend the free market system against the onslaught of Sovietism. And I think that wasn't very good for monopsony. Partially in a way because Joan Robinson herself was a real radical lefty and ultimately ended up pretty extreme relative to positions that I think most people would take today on a lot of issues like China and Korea and so on. So she wasn't a very good advocate for her own side. So what happened in the 70s was we had these two kinds of models. We had the development of search models, starting with McCall and Mortensen in 1970. Now almost immediately, like 1 minute after those papers were written, some very good economists started thinking about, well, where does this wage distribution come from? In the McCall model, the wage distribution is sort of given. And it was realized, Peter Diamond and Mike Rothschild realized right away that that was going to be a problem, because in those kind of models, you get this the Diamond paradox, that basically the firm wants to set the wage too low. So what happened then in the 1980s is that branch of search theory kind of evolved into a different idea, what I call search over match quality. So the DMP type models, Diamond, Martinson, Pissarides models, there's a search by an individual worker for a match. And that idea is still very pervasive in all kinds of economics, this idea of a match that's idiosyncratic. And in those basic models, wages have no allocative effect. Wages are determined afterwards, after you've decided the match should be made by some kind of rent splitting parameter. So then in the late 70s, Ken Burdett and then later on Burdett and Mortensen developed a model that did allow for wage setting. And basically the secret is to have on-the-job search. And with on-the-job search, then it's no longer the case that the firm has an incentive to lower the wage all the way to, you know, the very, very minimum. These models introduce very naturally a concept of a job ladder. A job ladder, I've been doing some archaeology on the word job ladder. So job ladder is a word that people have been using since the 1940s in the US, at least as far as I can tell. But people didn't really have a formal model of it. Probably the best example of a notion of job ladder was in a book by a guy named Arthur Oaken, the guy who also discovered Oaken's Law. But he was sort of a quasi-labor economist, a macro guy, and he had in mind a particular version of a job ladder type model. But he was not really an analytical economist much, so it's pretty painful to read, to tell you the truth. Those ideas, Burdett Mortensen type model with a wage setting, have been generalized in a lot of different directions in the last 20 years. Probably everyone's familiar with the Postel-Vinet and Robin generalization, which converts everything into sequential auctions, where firms basically are allowed to price discriminate, both in offering wages to workers that they're poaching from other firms and in potentially responding to offers from outside poachers. Whether the sequential auction model is actually a good empirical fit is a sort of a different question, but at least conceptually it does generalize these models, and if you have a little bit of sequential auction going on and a little bit of wage setting a la Mortensen Burdett, you might get something that might be a reasonable model for thinking about lots of different problems. I've already mentioned this other class of differentiated product demand curves idea. So the Dixit-Stiglitz framework with a CES and an infinite number of products have basically been adopted to labor in the last couple of years by a bunch of different authors. Berger et al., for instance, have a model of that. Coming at it from a slightly different perspective, the way that I kind of like to think about it, in those models there's basically one representative consumer. And so some macroeconomists like that because they have like one representative consumer in a lot of their models. But from a labor economics point of view, we always like to think, I think, about people making individual choices. And so a more natural differentiated product demand curve comes out from a multinomial logit type model, a la McFadden. And as Barry and BLP realized in the 1990s, this gives rise to a very convenient set of expressions for market shares. And in a paper I wrote in 2018 with Pat Klein, Jörg Heinig, and Anna Cardozo, we proposed using a multinomial logit model as a framework for thinking about a monopsonistic competition framework. And so people have kind of grabbed onto that and done a bunch of things with it. It turns out, this is actually a really interesting fact, the representative consumer CES and multinomial logit with individual consumers are isomorphic in market shares. So if all you're studying is market shares, you can do one or the other. And so that might be useful because there's some technologies that have been developed for dealing with the CES one consumer model, and there's some other technologies that have been developed for dealing with the multinomial logit, like nested logits. And depending on the problem, you could use one or the other. And these two guys, Anderson et al. And Verboten, have some proofs of the equivalence of those two empirically when you're just dealing with shares. If you're dealing with individual choices, obviously you need to have the multinomial logit model. So I couldn't resist for today's talk. I thought, well, I'll try and do something an example of this. So as I was putting together parts of this talk last spring for my American Economic Review, or American Economic Association talk, I realized that you could build a Chamberlainian type model of the labor market in which, if people remember their Chamberlain, now probably most of you people look too young to remember this, but when I was an undergraduate, you had to remember there was like the little D curve and the big D curve. And one of those curves was the downward sloping demand for a firm's products when it was changing its price, but nobody else was. And the other was kind of the equilibrium when everybody changed their prices together. And I always found that really hard to understand, because it wasn't formalized. But here's a way to do that in a labor market context. So let's imagine that the share of workers that prefer to work at a firm is our favorite multinomial logit framework. So epsilon log WJ is the kind of the subutility for working at firm J. And you could play around with this, but let's make it as simple as possible. So this gives rise to a share equation that looks like this third equation here, where N is the total number of workers in the market. And if you literally have it expressed here, notice that in this case, you've got a upward sloping supply curve to the firm, the little s curve, which has an elasticity of epsilon. But if all firms raise their wages together, basically everybody ends up back where they were. So it's got a vertical market supply curve, or a big S curve, where firms are adjusting. So if you think about that model, now you could relax that by having an outside good. So if you have an outside good, this is everybody from I.O. knows you can always fix all problems in I.O. with an outside good. So if you have the right outside good, that adds a term to the denominator. And depending on how many workers are moving from these jobs to the outside good as you change wages, then you get an upward sloping big S curve. Okay, so this would generalize very nicely. So what happens in a setting if you impose a minimum wage? Well, I want to start from an initially symmetric case where all firms are setting wages to be some level W0. So all firms are exactly symmetric and workers have idiosyncratic preferences and they're nicely distributed and everybody's getting an equal share of the workers. If we ignore the competitors part, then we're going to get the textbook monopsony prediction. So that's this curve here. So you've got a marginal revenue curve for the firm, that's the red line downward sloping. You've got an upward sloping inverse supply function with the elasticity 1 over epsilon in upside down space. And then the marginal factor cost equation for this supply curve is just translated upward by a certain amount. It's got the same slope, but translated up. So the firm, each firm is initially, as I've shown here, paying a wage on the blue line, they're on the supply curve, but they're setting marginal revenue product at a higher level, and the gap between those is the monopsonistic exploitation, as Robinson called it, which is, if you want to, you know, get right-wingers pissed off, just start talking about exploitation. Okay, so I don't recommend using that word. But that vertical gap is the markdown, equivalent to the markup in a price-setting equation. Okay, so what happens if you raise the minimum wage? Well, if you look at it from the point of view of a single firm and don't consider all the other firms, you get this classic picture. So you could raise the minimum wage to the level with the green line there. Now the marginal factor cost curve is the green line until it intersects with the marginal revenue product curve, and then it goes up. Okay, so the firm is going to increase employment if you ignore what its competitors do, and increase wages. And this was always kind of a problem when people, when I was writing my book with Alan Krueger on the minimum wage, and we had a little discussion on this model, and we kind of thought to ourselves, well, this is kind of a difficult thing because we're proposing that employment is going to go up in a monopsony model, and then that means the sales have to go up, and that means maybe consumer prices have to go down. But everybody has always found when you raise the minimum wage, the consumer prices go up. So how can that possibly be? That seems inconsistent with that. Well, if you introduce the fact back here, think about the denominator term now. So if all those other firms also raise their wage to the minimum wage, what's going to happen? Well, the supply curve to this firm is going to rise, okay, because no one's going to be willing to work for it at the old wage. They're going to have to raise their wage. And in fact, it's going to rise just enough so that the vertical line at the old level of employment intersects the marginal factor cost at exactly the same place. Okay, so you're going to get a new equilibrium where employment is exactly the same and everybody's paying a higher wage. Okay, so unfortunately, we weren't smart enough in 1992 to put that in our book, because I think if we had, we would have been, people would have liked us better. But it's now, I think, very clear that putting these kind of simple stories together allows you to think a lot more clearly about wage setting in a simple setting, even if you don't want to have like deeply strategic behavior. This is the least strategic behavior you can have, where you just think of all the other firms do something all at once, the way Chamberlain originally thought of it. Okay, so what about empirical research? What's happened in the last 30, 40 years, or almost 50, I guess now? Maybe people here don't know this, but modern labor economics started with the 1960 census in the US. Jorah Hanok had the first estimate of the return to schooling, published in the JPE from his thesis, 1966. around the same time, my thesis advisor, Orly Ashenfelter, wrote one of the first papers to look at the effect of trade unions on wages with individual level data using the Survey of Economic Opportunity. Frank Stafford had the SCF, and they looked at a bunch of different characteristics. And then things kind of took off with the CPS becoming available for people to do research with. Up to that point, the CPS had been collected but wasn't made available to researchers because individual researchers didn't have access to computers until about mid-60s. PSID and NLS come out around the same time. In this whole line of research, there was very little attention to employer wage setting. Virtually everybody was thinking about the Hicksian type model, where there's a bunch of different firms competing for workers, and so the labor market is perfectly competitive, and every firm has a horizontal supply curve. Why is that? Well, two reasons. One is, I think the leadership role of the Chicago-based economists, so many of the original researchers in this area were students of Greg Lewis or Gary Becker or both, people like Sherwin Rosen, many of the later generation of well-known labor economists were trained in that. And so they really emphasized this sort of Chicago-based model with basically perfect labor markets. But the other reason, even deeper than that, is that in the data sets that we had, there weren't any firm identifiers. So we didn't really know who you worked for. So it was really good to have a model where that didn't matter. So Hicks to the rescue. So Hicks said, okay, all that matters is the industry. Well, that's good. We got that. Okay, they recorded that. So we could work with that. And we didn't have to worry about the firm. So the Hicksian worldview is really convenient if you've got a data set with only supply side information, which is all we had for many, many years. There were a couple of exceptions to this line of work. One were studies of unions. And the thing about those studies, I wrote a few of these papers myself, actually. We weren't thinking about individual union firms most of the time. We were thinking about a union sector. So I wrote a paper where people had a job in the union sector or the non-union sector. So we were kind of thinking about, well, the non-union sector is the Hicksian sector, and then the union sector basically pays a premium above that. So it wasn't very much related to, there was no wage setting going on there because the union was setting a wage in combination with the firm in some sort of bargaining framework. And eventually that literature kind of evolved into studying bargaining and efficient bargaining or inefficient bargaining and so on. There was another area which was deeply confusing. I remember reading this as an undergraduate and not understanding what the papers were really trying to do. Don Parsons and John Pencavel in 1970 both wrote papers in top journals on quits. And they had models where the quit rate depended on the wage. Okay, now we all know today, but they didn't really understand then that that's a monopsony model. That's a dynamic monopsony model. They had equations. Actually, it's interesting. The elasticities they report are both consistent with the elasticities we have today. The quit elasticity is around 2 in both papers. So that's good news if you're trying to summarize the literature, because everybody gets numbers in that sort of order of magnitude. What was going on was they were deeply confused about Gary Becker's paper on relationship-specific capital, this firm-specific capital investment idea that Becker had. Becker was thinking about some sort of optimal contract. He didn't really use those words, but the way it's interpreted nowadays is he was talking about an optimal contract when there's relationship-specific investment. And he wasn't really thinking about firms setting wages themselves to trade off quits versus the cost of recruiting. But those guys were pretty confused about that. One paper that did sort of pick up on the Becker idea was Jovanovich's famous paper in 1979, Econometrica. This paper has an optimal contract when there's a match component, so it's a match world. And you're learning over time about the quality of your match. And if the match isn't good, you go back and sample again, and eventually you find a good match. And it has the property, and under Jovanovich's assumptions, that everybody gets paid the full value of the match. So the workers get all the surplus, which is actually the complete opposite of the Postol Vinay and Robin. The workers get none of the surplus in their model. But in Jovanovich, the workers get all the surplus. And so if that's true, then you can detect this shopping going on, this behavior by the tenure profile of wages. Now, I think that was kind of an interesting paper. Obviously, I tend not to think that workers get all the rents out of all relationships, but the thing about this paper that I think was actually, in a way, set the field back was it was all about worker-specific job ladders. So it has job ladders, that's good. He doesn't use the word job ladder in the paper, but he has a job ladder there, but everybody's climbing their own job ladder because we're all trying to search for our own good match. And I would say until about 2010 or so, that was basically the go-to model that everybody had. There are job ladders, but your job ladder and my job ladder are different because I'm looking for an employer that likes to have wine on Friday afternoons and you're more of a beer person, okay, or whatever. So Topel and Ward, for instance, a pretty well-known paper, interpreted mobility and wages of young workers in the Jovanovich framework. So they were saying, well, it's really important for people to move. That's a big part of wage growth of young workers. But they weren't thinking about it as young workers are moving from Starbucks to the automobile sector to the tech sector. They were thinking about it as young workers are finding their way up their own idiosyncratic job ladder, and each guy has their own route. I think, in my view, one of the pieces of evidence that really sort of called this whole idiosyncratic job ladders model to question was a very simple event study that Pat Klein and I came up with in 2010 or 2011 when we first started working with the administrative data from Germany. And what we did was we looked at wages of workers who switched jobs, and we wanted to do a model-free version of this. So we said, let's look at people who are switching jobs from quartiles of coworker pay, okay? So this is explicitly not, this is the almost complete opposite of Jovanovich, because now what I'm doing is I'm switching jobs based on what everybody else gets paid in that other job, okay? And what we showed, this is the picture that we had, is that if you are at a, like the bottom line here, the lowest one, is somebody who's at the first quartile of coworker wages and switches jobs, they switch in the middle between the first two and the second two, they switch jobs, everybody switches jobs there, and you go to another firm, but it has all the coworkers paid exactly the same first quartile, then you basically don't get anything. If you go from first to second quartile, you go up first to third, first to fourth. So this one here is somebody who's going from the first quartile of coworker pay to the fourth. And that's about 40 log points. Okay, that's a big wage increase. And that's kind of discovering a thing that everybody who grew up, I grew up in kind of a working class part of Southern Ontario where there's a lot of car companies and used to be a lot of old-fashioned manufacturing sector jobs. And everybody had a very clear idea of which were the better companies to work for. And when you graduated from high school, assuming you did graduate from high school, most of my friends didn't, but you went to work for one of those, and then you gradually tried to find your way to the higher one. And everybody knew full well that there was kind of like a hierarchy in these firms. And that's what that seems to show. And similarly, the other set of lines are the way down. Now, interestingly enough, that same graph looks almost the same in Brazil. So that's the Brazilian version from a paper I did with François Girard and Lorenzo Lagos and Edson Severini. So I think it's now clear that there may be some idiosyncratic component to job ladders, and maybe in certain sectors that's pretty important, but on average in the labor market, there's a big common component of a job ladder that needs to be taken account of. And one way to think about that is it's derived from some kind of model of why firms are setting different wages. There were a few other exceptions in that old literature. One of the PhD students from Princeton that Orly Eschenfelder and I advised, Dan Sullivan, had a really cool paper. These days, if he wrote this paper, it would be in a top journal. So he had hospitals, and he had data on all the employees' wages for all different kinds of wages, and he had big demand shocks affecting these hospitals arising from regulatory shifts. And what he showed was when he had a big demand shock at a hospital, a lot of workers' wages went up a little bit, 1 or 2 percentage points, but nurses' wages went up a lot. So it seemed very clear that in his data, at least, the nurses were the ones whose wages were most heavily influenced by kind of upward sloping supply, monopsonistic type setting. Okay, so what happened in the 1990s? Well, I think we had four new kinds of evidence. I'm going to briefly talk about these. I think these are kind of things that are still evolving and being refined and fixed up. One type of evidence is evidence on the wage elasticity of quits and recruiting, which is closely related to what I talked about before. Another type of evidence is on the pass-through of productivity to wages. A third type of evidence is on the actual relationship between wages and concentration of employers in the labor market. And then the third type of evidence is on basically antitrust-like topics about the labor market. And so I'm going to briefly talk about each of these. So in the quits and recruiting, the idea that that quits and the elasticity of quits with respect to wages tells you something about the elasticity of labor supply, that really wasn't clear until Burdett and Mortensen, believe it or not. In fact, there's still a surprising number of people who will say to me something like, well, I want to know about the long-run supply of labor to a firm. I don't care about the short-run supply. You'll still see people sometimes say that. The thing is, if you're like Amazon and you've got 500,000 blue-collar workers, the typical blue-collar worker at Amazon is staying for less than a year. So there is no long-run labor supply. There's only a constant churn of workers. And when you want to have a steady state labor force of a certain size, you can tell, given the wage you're paying, what that's going to cost you in terms of turnover. That's exactly the same as the supply function. And what Mortensen, Burdett, or even a simpler analysis shows is that the elasticity of supply to a firm in a dynamic setting really consists of two parts. The elasticity of recruiting, so if you, how much more do workers stay if you pay a higher wage, or will come if you pay a higher wage, and then the elasticity of quit, how much longer will they stay? Now, there's a really interesting trick. I think Alan Manning figured this out, the first, and everyone credits him, but it's a brilliant idea. He pointed out that in an equilibrium job ladder model, those two have to be equal in absolute value. Now, why is that useful? Well, because it's really easy to estimate the elasticity of quits. It's really hard to estimate the elasticity of recruiting. I can tell you that because one of my jobs in the tech sector was to try and estimate the elasticity of recruiting. And it's, to the best of my knowledge, it still isn't working, even when you're in charge of setting the wages. So it's pretty hard to do that. But it's pretty easy to get a quit elasticity. And so the Manning workaround is take the quit elasticity and multiply by two. And that's your elasticity of labor supply. And that is the elasticity that's going to enter in calculating the markdown for a monopsonistic wage setting equation. Now, there is one good piece of evidence on recruiting. Delbeau, Fanan, and Rossi have a pretty cool paper in the AER looking at, it's Mexican civil service jobs. And they got to mess around with the wages that were posted. And they found an elasticity of recruiting of equal to two, which is kind of a miracle, because that's, you know, that's where it should be. There's a lot of new work. I mentioned a couple of them here. There's a meta-analysis of this literature by Sokolova and Sorensen, 2021, last year. And they get estimates of the epsilon, like combining the two bits, in the range of 4 to 6. And so that's kind of the go-to model that people have in mind for a typical worker in a typical kind of study. It's quite possible that there's a huge amount of heterogeneity there. But that's kind of where we are, I think, in the literature. And there's a lot of interesting ways to generalize that, depending on how much structure you're willing to put on the studies. And so I think there's a lot more to be done there. A second type of evidence, when Klein and I were working on our model of wage setting, we started to think about something that I think was pretty obvious, and probably lots of people had thought about it before, but I'd never thought about it before, and that is, there's an old literature in labor economics talking about rent sharing. And it says, okay, more profitable firms, oftentimes larger firms, pay higher wages. And the interpretation or the spin that's usually put on that is that workers have some kind of bargaining power and force the firm to pay higher wages. And I always thought that was kind of weird because I've spent my entire career in North America and workers haven't got much bargaining power in North America. Like I would say zero. So it doesn't really make sense that, you know, workers' bargaining power is leading to rent sharing. Okay? But you get exactly what looks like rent sharing if firms have upward sloping supply curves. Because larger firms and more profitable firms basically have to hire a larger fraction of workers and maintain a larger fraction of workers. And so that's going to give rise to what appears to be a rent sharing, or what now I think we call, everyone wants to call, pass-through. And we calibrated a very simple version of a model, and we showed that that gave rise to estimate, you know, would be consistent with the patterns that you see in ordinary wage data. And a more serious effort is in a paper by Lamadon et al. In the JPE recently, which basically tries to do that with a broad set of firms and comes up with, I would say, estimates of the implied elasticities of supply that are very consistent with the rest of the literature, but derived in this very different way by inverting the relationship between how much pass-through there is. Now, interestingly enough, this is kind of a thing, it's possible that Penny actually wrote a paper like this. Did you do a pass-through paper? And yeah, in the trade literature, there was a lot of papers in the 1980s, Ann Harrison, I know, did one, looking at how exchange rates pass through, how exchange rate shocks pass through to product prices being sold. And that was a way to infer how much market power firms had. And this is basically that idea, just moved over. So there's a lot of good ideas in these other fields that can be completely ripped off and relabeled in labor economics. That's what I'm basically saying here. So here's a couple of more papers that are talking about that. There's a literature on the, an evolving literature on the number of competitors for labor services. Now, this area here, this gives IO economists the willies. The willies is that's a band, but it's also like a thing that, you know, that's like they feel really bad. And that's because they think of themselves as having gotten rid of that idea. In the 1950s, there was this, what they used to call structure conduct performance paradigm in IO, which basically focused on Herfindahl indexes and how much that affected prices. And there's a lot of problems with that structure. A really good example of this is in the Burdett and Mortensen model, there's an infinite number of buyers of labor, but each one has some market power. Okay, so there's not necessarily an easy mapping between the number of competitors and market power. But nevertheless, people love to look at how this works. And there's an interesting new fact in that paper by Azier et al. That for a typical occupation in the US labor market, a typical person has about four local competitors for their services. So if you're confined to a local labor market, there's actually a fairly small number of potential competitors. And there's a lot of jobs where the number of competitors is really small. And there's a lot of jobs where it's large. So that's equivalent to fairly high levels of Herfindahl concentration. And there's an evolving literature which is trying to do some design-based research on how changes in the number of competitors translate into changes in wages. So a couple of the studies that I mentioned here, the Azer et al. 2022 and Rintz's 2022 paper, basically try and instrument the Herfindahl index with some kind of shift share, or alternatively with some kind of what I would call, it's like an IO where you use the prices and characteristics in other markets as an instrumental variable for this market. I think that's the Hausmann instruments, isn't it? Is that the Hausmann instruments or the Brezhnev? That's the Hausmann instruments, yeah. So it's like the Hausmann instruments. So they're using that strategy for as a way to instrument the Herfindahl index in any given local area. And they're finding fairly significant, relatively small size, but statistically significant relationship between wages and Herfindahl indexes. I think a more interesting set of studies are looking for manipulations. So Arnold has an event study looking at mergers and acquisitions. Ben Mellick et al. Have one of these. Prager and Schmidt have a very interesting one with hospital consolidations, and this Guanzaroli paper, this is this one that I mentioned from Brazil, is a merger of pharmacies. And these papers have the advantage that they're studying the same labor market before and after. So you can actually do like a credible difference of differences kind of analysis, and you can see if there's pre-trends, and you can try and see does the movement make sense. So I think this is kind of the state of the art right now in this area. And I think if I suspect that there's going to be a lot more research along these lines in the next few years. How am I doing for time? What does it say? This is a topic that's some people's favorite. This is not, I haven't really written in this area, but my old friend Alan Krueger wrote a couple papers in this area, one with Orley, on conspiracies to suppress competition. And Orley was one of the expert witnesses in the Silicon Valley case. This is a really interesting case if you really ever want to see like the bad stuff that employers can do. So when Lucasfilm, when George Lucas sold Lucasfilm to Pixar, became Pixar, he sold it to Steve Jobs. And Jobs was such a clever businessman that he immediately got an arrangement going with Lucasfilm that they weren't going to bid for each other's workers, because he knew that that was going to be useful. So they had an agreement, which the other good thing about Steve Jobs was he used email. So they have the emails. So they had an agreement not to cold call each other's employees, to notify the other company if somebody was applying. So Lucasfilm was supposed to send an email to Pixar and say, one of your guys is applying for a job with us. How would you like that? And that there would be no, if you did switch firms, there would be no auctioning. There would only be a single offer, okay? Those were all part of the agreement. Now, ultimately, this agreement lasted 20 years, and it covered Microsoft, Google, and Adobe, and quite a few other Silicon Valley companies. So this was actually a very extensive conspiracy. Pretty interesting. It was like something that you really think that can't exist, but it did. And they got a lot of money out of that. There was another one that's maybe a little closer to heart if you're an academic. Duke University Medical School and University of North Carolina Medical School had an arrangement. Now, those two schools are side by side. And what's interesting about that arrangement is you think medical school faculty, aren't they on a national labor market? You know, like that's like a market with, you know, you're a professor of medicine. But they had an arrangement, and so they basically had to pay a lot of money to get because it was discovered. And then there's a lot of no poaching and non-compete arrangements all over the American economy, and I wouldn't be surprised in other economies as well that are kind of suspicious and have started to come under some legal scrutiny. Okay, so let me close by just talking briefly about what I see as the agenda for further work. And I think that one of the big agendas in the wage setting area is to try and think about what are the sources of monopsony power and how are we going to put that into a framework that makes sense and can be used to push the framework a little bit further. So right now there's sort of two. One is search and one is preferences. The search idea has a couple of natural pluses. I think the most interesting plus for the search idea is it's inherently dynamic. So it's all about turnover, okay? So you basically get, now you do have to have the, you do have to have that one little annoying fiction of the job destruction rate. Everybody knows that you always need delta. Delta raises its head and that drives everything at the end of the day because some of these jobs are exogenously being destroyed and then everybody has to move around all the time. So it is a bit of a fix, but it does also give rise very nice sets of predictions about job ladders and evolution of job ladders. Moscarini and Postovene have a very interesting paper showing how the job ladder evolves over the business cycle. And there's quite a bit of research, I think, showing that that's a really good idea, that that's actually true. And strangely enough, what it's showing is that in really bad times, it's the good firms that stop hiring, much more so than the bad firms. So, and that's consistent with something that we all know, but we just didn't really think about how to put it together. We all know that you don't want to graduate in a recession, okay? Because you're going to end up working at McDonald's instead of Harvard. So it's literally, that seems to be true. Now, why that is kind of interesting. No one seems to have a really good idea why do the bad firms keep hiring and the good firms stop. The minus about search, to me, is that I always think that everybody knows where the good jobs are. because I, you know, growing up in my part of Southern Ontario, we all knew the names of the companies, and we all knew that, you know, you would want to move here rather than here. So I find it a little bit hard to figure out exactly where that search is coming from. What's the friction? I don't think it's exactly an information friction. And then you've also got this labor-starved thing. The preference story is a little different. The preference story says that basically everybody's happy with where they are. I'm working at Berkeley, and even though I earn a lot less than if I worked at Stanford, I'm happy because I, you know, I like Berkeley. I mean, we've got better grocery stores, which is true. And our weather's a little better. It's not quite as hot. So that's an example of the, that's the way the model that, that Klein and I have worked on. That any IO model has that basically everybody's happy with what they've got, and price dispersion is reflecting the relative numbers of people who have different kinds of preferences in combination with the relative costs of producing or a value that they can produce in different activities. Now, the minus of that story is that the strictest model has that everybody knows about all those other products and they just don't want to get them. So there's no job ladder, okay? There's no sense in which you're better off going to a higher wage job. Because in these models, it's basically just like the demand for wine. Okay, there's many kinds of wine. Some people buy one, some people buy another. But there's no real ladder of quality or whatever that you're going to climb up if you have the opportunity. So there's something in between those two that presumably is going to ultimately emerge. Alan Manning has suggested combining the two in different ways. And I think that's going to be something that's going to happen. I'm going to be done in 2 minutes. Another thought, and I think this is very promising. A very promising Brazilian student, Daniel Hanvinkel, has a really interesting paper where he's laid out one of the kind of Satinger-like task-based production functions. These are models with pretty complicated models. But these models have a characteristic that firms have very strict standards for who they want to hire. So there's a lower bar for who you want to hire. And that might be a way to get something like an IO type model of preferences for jobs in combination with firms setting minimum standards, which means that some people are rationed out of jobs. And at other times, firms may lower the bar and hire people that they wouldn't hire in sometimes. So that might be a way to get at this idea of cyclical upgrading. We need a lot more work in all of that. And I think that this is going to be the future in this area is really simultaneously working on combinations of models and innovative data sets which have either design-based features like the mergers or acquisitions or some kind of instrumental variables, or have very novel descriptive features like something where I can see particular aspects of the productivity of different firms or something. So I think that there's going to be in the coming decade a more close interweaving of the development of the empirical research with a little bit more reliance on some kind of theoretical framework, because I think we've come pretty far, and that seems to be the direction that we need to go the next step. And that's going to closely follow, I think, what's happened in for instance, in the trade and IO fields, where there's been, you know, big improvements in what's going on, but it had to involve some combination of theory and evidence and careful modeling as well as careful data development. And I'm going to stop there.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Professor Card. I think we have, according to my time, and please correct me if I'm wrong, Sergio, but I think we have like 15 minutes at least for questions, I guess. So I think we can collect maybe a round of like three, and then you can go over it, and then we keep going until we run out of questions. So I'm going to start just to break the ice very quickly. So my question is, I think it's somewhat related to this last one of these last points of this the more empirical
analysis of monopsony power requires like a definition of the labor market, right? And I think empirical work up to today is basically kind of focuses on very specific markets and then types of workers and so on. But I mean, a more general treatment would have to consider like substitutability across occupations, substitutability across different regions, like cost of migration for different types of workers, different types of jobs. And it's, I mean, conceptually, I think it's we understand, but empirically, how we would define in general terms, I guess, how we would see like a way of to implement in more general terms, a definition, not a doc definition of what the relevant labor market is from the perspective of a firm, right? So,
right. Do you wanna, I have a couple of thoughts on that. Other people may have other ideas too. I mean, but. So one good thing we have in the labor market is we see, you know, in a lot of the data sets like Heiss or the LEHD in the United States or the IAB's data set from Germany, we see workers evolving over time. And so we can construct networks of the jobs that you used to have at what firm and the job you have now. And people are using that already to look at like internal labor markets and say, okay, if I see somebody starting at this firm in this occupation, is that a fast track to a managerial job or is that kind of something that's going to stay the way it is? And I think you can use the same ideas thinking about like if a bunch of different workers are heavily connected with a bunch of firms, then that seems to be a labor market. I think that there's a lot of, the one good thing about networks is the computer scientists have developed the most amazingly efficient software. So you can do the most amazingly complicated calculations on a network in about 0 seconds because they've got all this stuff coded up so beautifully. So I think that if somebody thinks about it and is a bit creative, there's probably a lot of arbitrage to do there. Maybe some proof of concept, and then you know, with a very simple example, and then build it out to a broader model. But I definitely think by using the combination of where you were, what you used to do, who took your place, sort of, it'd be possible to do something. No.
Thank you. So let me take a couple of questions. So, Tomas, who actually is working exactly on that problem, right?
Yeah. Hi, David. Thank you for the talk. So you mentioned the next steps for research, and you also mentioned that labor is evolving just like I.O. Did 30 years ago. But I don't see any mention to how I.O. evolved into sectorial papers, for example. So you have a paper on each industry, because each industry might have a different type of competition. So do you have any opinions on that regarding the labor market?
Yeah, I think, the labor markets, you know, the broad sector of the labor market, let's say the, you know, semi-skilled workers in a large category of occupations might be quite similar across markets. So you might be able to model 25% of the workforce with one model or 20%. But I think if you were studying, like I've had students study the market for the all the skilled workers that work in the back end of making a movie. So the people that are like, you ever wonder what a key grip is? So all of those kind of guys, that's a very specialized market. And it's very, you know, somewhat complicated, and that's more like an I.O. topic. So I think we're going to have both kinds.
So I have a question. David, I'm here.
Oh. Here. Sergio.
So I would like to know about your thoughts on the gig economy and the elasticity of supply in a situation in which, for example, you work as a driver and may work either for Lyft or for Uber at the same time, same day. So that should have an impact on elasticity of supply. And what do you think that should be the regulation to deal with monopoly power in that gig economy? Should they be hired as workers? Should we treat them as workers? Or should their contracts be regulated by an antitrust agency?
That's an interesting question. I mean, there was an attempt to move in that direction, and it was propositioned away in California, right? So Uber and Lyft put many millions of dollars into changing the law and saying we couldn't do that. I think the perspective that Penny was offering in her talk, the idea that in some ways the gig economy is like an informal economy, is pretty important. Actually, a couple of my colleagues are working with data from the tax records of California. There's a lot of tax evasion, huge amount of tax evasion in the gig economy in the U.S. So I wouldn't be surprised if we could effectively model it as one of the big benefits is tax evasion. And another part of it is, you know, because you know if you're a self-employed person, you can declare lots of junk under U.S. tax law, right? And so that even if you declare all your income from Lyft, you still can declare some deductions that you couldn't get otherwise. So I think that's one important part. In terms of market power, good question. There are a couple of studies that look at what happens to the supply of labor to one of those two firms when one of them comes in. Sydney Caldwell has a paper like that. And so she's got an estimate of the cross-firm elasticity of labor supply, as well as the extensive margin elasticity to gig jobs as a whole. And in principle, those give rise to essentially market power for those two firms. I don't know anybody's tried to figure out if that's how they're setting their premiums. There's a few other players in that market now because of the delivery services, which are also in the gig business. And they're all basically trying to get good deals. I know a little bit too much about that one, so I can't say much more about that one. But there's definitely a lot of careful economic modeling of the degree of market power that the people that are setting the prices for those things have. Yeah. So I wouldn't. You could think about that as monopsony. That's a good idea. I hadn't really thought of it, you know, as a research topic, but I think it could be.
How are you?
David, I was curious. You mentioned towards the end new descriptives or, you know, measurement as a potential avenue. One thing that came to mind, and I was wondering what your thoughts were. So across many dimensions now you have elicitation of beliefs about, you know, individuals about earnings in the future, firms about revenues. But if you take, for instance, the Survey of Consumer Expectations and the New York Fed, one of the things that they ask of employees, people that are currently employed, is what is the likelihood that you're going to get a job offer in the future? You could even think about if you didn't have your current job,
yeah,
what would be the probability of getting a job in a similar firm within commuting distance?
Yeah.
Do you think these types of data could also be informative to determine the degree of market power, perceived market power?
Yeah. Actually, Sydney Caldwell and Ingrid Hagel are doing a study like that in Germany. They're combining the administrative data set with the survey, and they're basically trying to figure out, like, so they can see somebody working in a market in a certain occupation where it looks like they're at one of the lower wage firms. And they're trying to figure out, like, by asking a little bit, like, why don't you go work for Siemens? And so I think there's quite a bit of work like that's underway right now. It takes a long time because there's a lot of confidentiality rules to get around and things like that. Some countries, it's going to be almost impossible in the U.S. It's going to be a lot easier, I think, in Brazil, actually. So,
even if you take, the Survey of Consumer Expectations and somehow link it with, which is a government survey, like it's run by the New York Fed.
Yeah, the Fed isn't the government, actually.
Oh, that's right.
That's right. So actually, they probably have a little more flexibility. The Census Bureau is completely hamstrung. They can't do anything. But it's possible that somebody working with the New York Fed could, yeah. I wouldn't be surprised. But I think it's the good thing that's really happened in labor economics is a lot of these issues are really present. You know, I've done papers in Italy, Portugal, Germany, and Brazil with the same technology. And it's not exactly the same. Things are a little different. But there's a lot of commonality. So if somebody has a particular insight about how to do this in Brazil, I think you can get that paper, you know, people will respect it and it'll be valued. And that's a little different than it was a long time ago, where everything had to be about the US. So I think that's a really positive development.
Thank you so much, David. Yep. Thank you. We're going to move to Lorenzo, I guess, right? The next one. So Lorenzo graduated from Columbia a few years ago. I don't have to read that, so I can remember. And even now he's an assistant professor at Brown University. Even though he's Mexican, we are lucky enough to have Lorenzo working with Brazilian data, doing a lot of work on rice, and actually doing a lot of work on unions. That has been a topic, I think, largely overlooked by labor economists in Brazil. There's a lot of research on labor in Brazil, but very little on unions. So if you keep going like that for a couple of years more, we're going to give you a passport, Lorenzo. And please.
Okay. Thank you to the organizers and INSPER for inviting me. So this is joint work with Viola Corradini and Garima Sharma. It's a paper on collective bargaining for women, how unions can create female-friendly jobs. So just to situate this paper with the previous presentation, there is, as Dave mentioned, growing evidence that firms have some discretion in how they set wages, and for that, for a similar case, you can make for amenities. But there are a lot of labor market institutions that could impact that discretion, one of them being collective bargaining, right? And what we'll see in this paper is that unions' priorities, or essentially one of the agents that is affecting that sort of setting policy, is gonna have an impact on the labor market. Okay, so we know that gender gaps persist even in very integrated labor markets, so women tend to have their labor supply choices constrained by whether it be biological demands or social demands like gender norms. But on top of all of this, it tends to be the case that workplaces are unfriendly towards women. And to the degree that that could be sort of removed or ameliorated, perhaps women would be supplying more hours of labor or investing more in their careers. So this begs the question of why aren't workplaces better designed for women? And you can think of two views of that. One would be a more traditional view that it's too expensive to provide the desired amenities, such as like maybe childcare assistances, extended maternity leave, or flexible work schedules. That is, the marginal worker is not valuing these types of amenities. Less traditional view would be simply that the people who are deciding how to set compensation are not prioritizing women's preferences. So in come collective bargaining. So we can think, as I mentioned, of collective bargaining as shifting how workplace policies are set because they constrain employers' discretion in wage and amenity setting. So if there is a shift in union objectives, this may facilitate the creation of more female-friendly jobs. So in this paper, we're gonna ask whether prioritizing women's preferences make workplaces more female-friendly, and if so, at what cost? We're gonna study this in the context of Brazil, where there are large gender disparities, about an unadjusted wage gap is about 10 log points, but also a country that has extensive collective bargaining. So about 50% of the private formal workforce is covered by some collective bargaining agreement, or CBA. And as has been mentioned, Brazil has wonderful data, so we're gonna use RAIS, allows us to track workers across jobs and see the earnings that they obtain, but we're gonna add to this also the CBAs that are covering these workplaces, and these CBAs essentially contain in them some general sense of the amenities that are provided by the firm, or at least common amenities. So we'll have that, plus we are gonna use a quasi-experiment, which we're gonna call the Cucci reform of 2015. Cucci is a union central, so those are umbrella associations that unions can affiliate to. And essentially what it did is in 2015, it made women the centerpiece of the bargaining agenda for all affiliates. So this allows us to do a difference in difference strategy where essentially we're gonna be exploiting the variation in unions' affiliation to different union centrals. So those that are affiliated to CUCH are gonna be the treated, those that are not affiliated to CUCH are the control, and we're gonna see how outcomes evolve over time pre and post this 2015 change. And the important thing here is that this shift in institutional priorities of CUCH-affiliated unions should be uncorrelated to the local labor demand of a given establishment or the workers' preferences. As I'll explain, in Brazil, workers and employers really do not have a say in terms of which union is gonna be representing them in collective bargaining. Okay, so the talk is gonna be split into three parts. We'll see how far I get, at least through part two. The first one is more of like a classification exercise, which is what are female-friendly amenities? We're going to propose a new data-driven approach that builds on Sorkin's work about PageRank values of firms. Then the second part is going to be the main part, where we're going to look at the question about prioritizing women in collective bargaining. And what we'll find, basically using that identification strategy I just mentioned before, is we're going to see disproportionate gains for women in terms of amenities on paper and in practice. So on paper is going to be the clauses that are in the CBAs, and in practice there are going to be outcomes that we're able to observe in HICE. We're then going to look at revealed preference outcomes for women, and we're going to see that women are actually valuing these changes in the sense that they're more likely to stay at these firms and try to transition into these firms. And interestingly, we find no clear trade-offs in terms of employment, wages, or profit. So it seems like, and I'll explain a bit more about that, that it's kind of like a win-win situation, suggesting that the original kind of like bargaining outcome was inefficient, and this kind of shift in priorities kind of uncovered something that was being left on the table. And then the last part, we're going to try to quantify the welfare implications for workers. And what we'll find is that the improvements in women's welfare are not coming at the expense of men. OK, so before I jump into these three sections, I feel it's important, even though it's a Brazilian audience, to give some context of collective bargaining in Brazil. So two types of CBAs. There is the sectoral agreements. This is where the union is negotiated with an employer association that is representing the employers in a given industry and geographic region. And these types of agreements kind of set general floors for that cell. Then there are the firm-level CBAs, which is the union is negotiating with an individual employer. And these kind of agreements provide augmenting provisions for the workers there. So sectoral is sort of like, imagine with like all banking establishments in Sao Paulo, and then the firm level would be the union is negotiating directly with Itaú, Unibanco, or something like that. For the first part of the paper, where we're going to classify amenities as female-friendly, we'll be using the sectoral CBAs. And then for all the second part about the Cucci reform, we're going to be using the firm-level CBAs to kind of decouple sort of how we classify female-friendly amenities from our empirical strategy. The workers are kind of assigned to unions, and whatever union they're assigned determines the CBA that covers them. And that is essentially two reasons. One is assignment is simply based from your category, which is essentially industry, and geography where you work. If you're in the banking sector in Sao Paulo, there's only one union that is already assigned to you to represent. In addition to that, any CBA that is negotiated by that union has universal coverage. That means you don't have to be a union member to be covered by this agreement. And a very similar framework is occurring on the employer association side for employers. Union priorities are going to play a central role in the whole negotiation process. In Brazil, you essentially have CBAs negotiated every year. All of these agreements on average last a year. The maximum is 2 years. And the negotiation process starts with the union sending a list of demands or a list of claims to the employer that are voted by a general assembly. So whatever is kind of like occurring at that process is going to set the stage for what is being negotiated in the future. So last slide before we jump in. Two very important entities I want you to keep separate in your mind is the unions. So the unions are representing the workers in collective bargaining. And the other one is the union centrals. Union centrals do not engage in collective bargaining at all. All they do is they coordinate activities among affiliated unions. So there are 9 different union centrals in Brazil. Cucci is one of the, if not the largest one, is the one we're going to be focusing on. OK, so let's jump to it. The first part, what are female-friendly amenities? So the one way to do this is simply an intuitive classification. So the co-authors and I identified 4 themes, leaves, maternity and childcare, workplace harassment and discrimination, and flexible hours. So essentially, these came from Cucci's fight plan, which I'll describe later on, but also from existing literature on what women workers tend to value. And we just picked 20 CBA clause types that fit these themes. So what are these clause types? So in the CBA data, which comes from Sistema Mediador, essentially the clauses are already pre-classified. You have to choose where it falls within these subgroups, which it's not very readable here, but you'll see the subgroup here is a maternity leave, and then you write the text of the agreement. So you can easily identify the type of clause that is being used. So that's one way. The more interesting, and I think a contribution of this paper, is our data-driven approach. So the goal here is that we want to identify the clause types that correlate with women's value of working at a specific establishment relative to men. So the assumption here is that there are, in some sense, gender-specific job ladders. Everyone has some value separately, men and women, for working at a firm. So that's this V here. And we're going to assume that this is linear in wages and amenities. So I value working at firm J as a man because men get a certain wage premium at this firm, but then also because there are some amenities that are being offered here. And we want to do is find these amenity types Zs for which the value for women is essentially bigger than that for men. How do we implement this? We essentially use kind of like get the predictive beta hats that come from running a lasso on essentially taking the women versus men version of this equation. The Vs is where we're borrowing from Sorkin's paper. So this is a page rank value of working at a firm, and the intuition is that essentially a firm is highly valued if it's able to attract workers from other valuable firms and not lose many workers. So you can do that with linked employer-employee data. Then these wage premiums come from AKM models, which I won't get into describing here. And then these versions or these proxies of the amenities that we do is the count of the clauses from the sectoral agreements that are covering a given establishment. We pick the top 20 clauses as the female-centric ones. And the neat thing that we can also do with this approach is that we get male-centric one, which are going to be the 20 bottom clauses. So all seems intuitive. What do we find? So in this table, the first column is just giving you the intuitive female clauses. And then the second one is the data-driven female clauses. The third one is the male data-driven clauses. And in red, we highlight the overlap between the intuitive version and the data-driven version. So our data-driven approach kind of does overlap quite a bit with the intuitive version. We see things like childcare assistance, adoption leave, paid leave, maternity protections being picked up. There are other things that are picked up that we hadn't intuited, like absences, extensions and reductions of the workday, medical exams, health education campaigns, things that maybe ex post also make sense. On the male side, we also kind of found it interesting that a lot of the items that come up are related to pay, like on-call pay or profit sharing agreements, and also things related to workplace safety. So there's, for example, life insurance, hazard pay, the CPAS, which are the accident prevention committees. All those types of clauses seem to be the type that men value disproportionately relative to women. So, okay, there is some intuition to this. Does this kind of pass a sense check? So we do several out-of-sample sense checks. This is the one I want to show to you now. What we're doing here is plotting here the share of women at an establishment on the x-axis. And on the y-axis, we have the mean clause count for both female and male-centric clauses. And this is from firm CBAs. So this is separate from the sectoral CBAs that we were using to classify. And we find that as you have more women in an establishment, you see an increase in the female-centric clauses and a decrease in the male-centric clauses. And one of the interesting features here is that the increase in the female clauses kind of only happens once women become the majority. So that's once you pass this 50% threshold line, kind of indicating that to some degree maybe representation of women in the workforce matters. So now that we have a measure of the amenity side of things, let's jump into the main question that we answer in this paper, which is, does prioritizing women change the workplace? And if so, at what cost? Okay, so this Cucci reform that I mentioned has two parts. The first one is a gender quota. So they reserved 50% of all the seats in the national and state boards for women. And what I'm showing you here is the result of how the share of women in the national board evolved for Cucci versus the average of all the other centrals. So you see that, in fact, in 2015, there is this jump almost to 50%. Importantly, this was decided in the National Congress that Cucci had in 2012. So we're going to use unions affiliations to union centrals in 2012 for defining treatment, simply in case there is some anticipation of this effect. The other thing I want to highlight is that this is at the union central level. This is not a requirement for local unions to change the composition of their leadership. We do find some small positive spillover effects, but I don't want to spend too much time on that. The second, and I think more important part, is this female-centric fight plan. So essentially, in the 2015 Congress, they get together and they draft this document that is going to spell out the type of directives they want their unions to follow. So one of the things that they focus is the types of clauses that they want their unions to fight for. This included extended maternity, childcare benefits, flexible work schedules. And in addition to that, they also wanted the unions to push for more women in leadership positions. It was nothing specific of what to do, but encourage them to put more women in leadership roles, and also to have women involved in the drafting of these list of claims or list of demands that initiate the negotiation process. The last thing I want to emphasize about this reform is that it's simply a shift in priorities. It's not that now CUCH-affiliated unions have more bargaining power, right? I just want to, have that clear in people's mind as the way that we're interpreting this reform is just about priorities. It's not about bargaining power. Okay, so that's the reform. We use a difference in difference strategy. So essentially, we're thinking of this as a top-down focus on women that starts in 2015. So we're going to have some time-varying outcome. And in your simple diff and diff, what we're interested in is in these betas, which are the interaction between treatment and the year-specific fixed effects. So YAT is some outcome variable that could be measured at different levels. So there's the female-centric clauses for the different union establishment pairs. You could think of the share of female managers at a given establishment. That could be the unit of observation. Or if you're thinking about incumbent workers, you could be looking at their wages. We're going to have fixed effect for whatever unit you're using at the time and also year fixed effects. And our treatment dummy is whether the union was affiliated to CUCH, again, in 2012. In fact, if you look at transitions in affiliations between like unions to union centrals, there's very little of that occurring and nothing that seems to indicate that unions are switching away or towards CUCH after 2012. We have some industry year and geography year fixed effects, and we cluster our standard errors at the establishment level. The identification assumption, again, is that the outcomes of these CUCH-affiliated observation units would have evolved similarly to all the other units had the reform not taken place. Okay, so first set of results is going to focus on amenities on paper, then amenities in practice, and then we'll look at how some revealed preference measured for whether women value these changes, and then we'll end with the trade-offs, which are looking at wages, employment, and profits. Okay, so amenities on paper. So in this table, you have in the first section the intuitive definition female clauses, basically all clauses in column one, and then broken into the four different themes that we use to identify this intuitive classification. We see an increase in both the intensive margin, so simply the count of these clauses, but also if you think of these clauses as a share of all clauses. And a lot of this effect is driven by clauses on leaves and maternity. When we move to the data-driven approach, we also see for females the similar effect, so an increase both in the count and in the share. And for the males, you actually see a decrease here that we explain in more detail in the paper is actually driven by something later on in 2017. But you see a slight decrease in terms of as a share of clauses. And in fact, when you look at the ratio of female to male clauses, you see more female clauses. So essentially what's happening is you have the composition of CBAs are becoming more female oriented. And equivalently, you can think of this as being less male-oriented. Just one set of figures to convince you that we at least do not reject the parallel trends assumption. This is showing you as a share of clauses what's happening to female clauses and male clauses over time. One kind of going back to the point about representation mattering, what we do is some quick heterogeneity analysis where we fully interact a dummy HI that is going to be capturing some form of low representation of women and see whether that's driving the effects. So in column two, we have whether there are few women at the establishment. Column three is whether there are few women in the union board. And column four is whether there is no woman vice president or president at the union. And we'd see across all these three different measures of, let's say, little representation of women, that the effects are actually larger, which again suggests that representation at baseline, both in terms of the number of workers, but also the union, it could be, or at least in those places, is where there were a lot of gains made for women. So all of these results that I've explained so far are just things on paper. In practice, using the types of clauses that were identified and what is available in HEIS, we came up with some measures. So we're looking here at the share of women among managers. So we see, relative to baseline, about a 3% increase in that outcome. We also look at the share of women who take extended maternity leave. We see that that increases by about 14% relative to the baseline. And interestingly, we don't see that those women are less likely to return to their establishment of employment. And then kind of building off of what we saw from the male-centric amenities that they valued some workplace safety provisions, we look at the share that are taking injury leave as as an outcome, and we don't see any statistically significant effects on that, indicating that there doesn't seem to be a deterioration in workplace safety. Okay, so now moving on to whether women are actually valuing these changes, we're gonna look at first one type of revealed preference outcome, which is retention. So we see that there is higher retention among incumbent workers, especially for women. So this is the difference between men and women. So there's a significant difference between the two. And women of childbearing age are also more likely to be staying at these firms. So again, the fact that we have more retention means women are sort of valuing these changes or suggest. The fact that there's no decrease for men also suggests that men are at least not being made worse off, or at least incumbent men are not being worse off. Now, this is just incumbents. If you look overall at, for example, share of women or the job queue of a firm, we also see something quite consistent. So we don't have, we say it's job queuing, but we don't actually have applicants in the HEIS data. But what we do have is the first 3 months are essentially probationary months where the employer can fire you without paying severance. So these are kind of like trial periods for workers. And we see that the share of women kind of increases among after the reform in the treated units. We also see more women job spells appearing at the treated firms. So again, kind of indicating that women are valuing the changes that are occurring at these firms, and at least more than men. So now jumping to the trade-offs part. Are there any trade-offs in employment? So we don't see any effect on log employment. And as I mentioned before in the previous outcomes, there's a higher share of women among the spells that are observed at a given firm. So we do see more spells from female workers. However, this rise in women that are trying to get into these firms is offset by the separation. So it's not that the composition of the firm is becoming more female-centric. So no decrease in employment. What's happening in terms of wages? So here, the outcome is mean log wages separately for men and for women, and also separately for those who are have tenure more than a year versus those that have tenure below a year. We don't see any impact on those and any impact on the mean gender wage gap. Now, one of the nice comments that I got when I presented this at INSPER less than a month ago was that, well, maybe you don't care about the mean of these wages. So what we did is we, as I forget who suggested, but we went and extracted the actual wage adjustments that are negotiated in the CBAs and saw whether there was any impact there, and we find no negative impact there. Then finally, in terms of profits, you don't observe profits in HEIS, unfortunately. We do have the wage portion of labor costs, which is a wage bill, which is also unchanged. We proxy profit with establishment exit. We don't see any change in exit. And then you have some measures of profit margins in the Orbis data, but this is a very selected subsample. We don't find any effects there either. But in general, as I mentioned, this is simply a shift in priorities. It's not an increase in bargaining power of unions. You wouldn't expect that the union is able to extract more surplus after the reform. So there are theoretical reasons to believe that profits would not be changing. So to summarize, there's this top-down decision to prioritize women that led to more female-friendly jobs. As we saw, there were improvements for female-friendly amenities on paper and in practice. And we saw that representation at baseline mattered for these effects, and that the changes were valued by women, and that these changes occurred without any meaningful cost that incurred either by workers or by employers. And in particular, I think it's important to recognize that there's no evidence of men being worse off. So what's the implication of this? So this is consistent with models of utility posting, where the utility that's posted for women is improving without a decrease in the utility posting for men. And it suggests that shifts in priorities are do not need to be redistributive. So in some sense, there's some wage and amenity setting that's occurring, and now one of these agents is shifting its priorities to a specific subgroup of workers. It need not imply that it's going to be redistributing from another set of workers to that particular set of workers that are of interest. So since I have 5 minutes, I'm going to fly a bit through the welfare implications. But let me just describe briefly what's happening here. So in consumer welfare theory, economists tend to think about welfare in terms of, you know, if there's an introduction of a new or an improved set of goods, the changes in the price index will be able to tell you something about welfare, because it's telling you how expensive has it now become to buy one additional utile. So taking that same intuition into worker welfare, you can think, okay, so what happens to worker welfare once we improve the workplaces? So in this case, you could use a wage index, which is going to tell you how much you're getting paid to work one additional disutility hour. So you know, it's in a specific model with CES preferences and no job rationing, like similar to the types of model that Dave mentioned, we come up with a sufficient statistics approach that allows us to go to the data and essentially calculate wage bill shares, a dispersion of these wages, and the wages themselves as the statistics we need to know for couch and non-couch establishments before and after the change. And then with that, we come up with the following numbers, and essentially the welfare for women is improving by about 6%, and there's really no deterioration in the welfare for men. So to conclude, we started with the question, why aren't workplaces better designed for women? And what we find in the case of Brazil is that it's essentially about decision makers, or at least partly about decision makers not prioritizing women's needs. And we find that female-friendly jobs are feasible without any clear losses. Now, I think to kind of like take the results of this paper to more of a policy world, I think it's very natural for policymakers to think that the priorities of political leaders have an impact on the policies that are implemented. And there are some economic papers that kind of study about, you know, for example, whether you have a female leader and how that impacts what's being represented in the political process. If we live in a world where there is a wage setting and an amenity setting, then it becomes relevant that the priorities of, let's say, union leaders or firm leaders could then have an impact on the labor market. And this is something that is hard to do, but I think Hank Farber gave us some guidance on that, and thinking about the objective function of the labor union is very hard to think of, or to formalize that. But unions end up being pretty political. And so the process of how they come to reaching decisions is kind of almost like a political economy question. And I think that's something that deserves further study. If you were to have any policy takeaways from this presentation, I think it's the following. One is that the institutional priorities can benefit or hurt underrepresented workers. This is not a paper of like unions are good, unions are bad. It's saying if you shift priorities, you can actually end up advancing a certain group. But I think quite interestingly and somewhat controversial is that raising the voice of these groups in particular can uncover some sort of efficiency gains or things that were being left on the table. So with that, I'll finish and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Lorenzo. I think since you sped through the welfare analysis, I think we have like 2 minutes if there are like one or two questions. I saw this paper 1 month ago here, so I don't have any questions. So there is a question back there.
In the matter of the policy takeaway that uncovering this interest may cause efficiency gains, wouldn't you be worried that maybe these results that you got for this specific group is not applicable for other underrepresented groups?
No, of course. It's just, you know, it's suggesting that this can happen. It doesn't need to be the case that it applies to all types of groups.
Yeah. You mentioned priority. Priority means putting some things and taking out others. Did you measure the other things that went out of the agenda and what happened?
The fight plan from Kuchi, you know, they only mentioned what they're going to focus on. I guess it would be interesting, and we haven't done this, to see what their fight plan was in 2012 or before that, I guess, to see what clauses are no longer on that list of priorities. Now, that doesn't mean that they were completely deprioritized, but at least that they lost their status as the top thing to think about.
And if there were consequences of getting those clauses out of the list.
So at least if you think that the world, that there's just two groups of workers, men and women, our evidence doesn't show that, you know, men were worse off. But that's also a simplistic view of, you know, the labor market. It could be that it was old men near retirement, like some subset of that, that were the losers of this policy. It's just very hard to pin that down.
Or other amenities that were in the list that now are not, and those suffer or something.
All right, not classified. If you can do an analysis that's clause by clause, and that's like a bit messy because your parallel trends assumption is unlikely to hold when you go to that level. But yeah, we do have, at some point we did document that there are some clauses that fall. I believe some were like on training of workers, things like that were being lost.
Last speaker of this session is Sergio Firpo, my colleague. Sergio is the Instituto Unibanco Professor of Economics here at the INSPER. He's a fellow of the Econometric Society, has done extensive work on the econometrics of inequality and the econometrics of distributions, and also very, very policy relevant applied work on inequality in Brazil and labor markets more generally in Brazil. So Sergio, please.
Thank you, Rodrigo. So it's an honor to be in this session with David, who was my professor at Berkeley, and also with Lorenzo, who has done interesting work on using Brazilian data. So this is a paper that I'm writing with Fabiano and Alison. Fabiano is a PhD student here, and Alison just graduated, also as a PhD. And we are working on trying to understand how informality may induce an increase in volatility of earnings, or would that have an impact in reducing it? So the idea is basically, if you remember what Penny told us this morning about informal sector serving as a cushion, you can think of wage volatility, right, when you transition from a formal job to an informal job, having an impact in decreasing the volatility, because now you don't go to zero earnings. If you leave the formal sector, if you don't have any informal sector, you would get unemployment. So you have no labor income from that situation. So your volatility, when you compare before and after, would increase, right? But the thing is, if you have a cushion, as an informal sector is, that could actually decrease the variation that you have in your labor income. But at the same time, we know that informal sector, workers in the formal sector, they are much more affected by how the economy affects those sectors, right? So they don't have an employer or a firm right, as to block changes in their in demand of their products or services if they are self-employed, for example. So that should have an impact also in terms of volatility of their wage or their earnings. Labor income would be affected if you are in the informal sector. So there's this combination of increasing and decreasing volatility that can be studied, and that's what we do here. So, and why is that important? Well, most of the papers about wage volatility are in a context of developed economies in which you have long panels and high formality. So there is no informality unless you treat those workers that are working for contract, like Uber drivers, right, as kind of informal workers. But you have you don't have the same context that you have here in the region or specifically in Brazil. And also, volatility here, labor income volatility, may be more important in a situation in which you don't have poor workers, they don't have access to credit, so they cannot smooth consumption easily. So any decrease in their labor income may have welfare negative impacts, much more than in developed countries or economies in which access to credit is much more widespread. Also, savings is something that poor workers may have difficult to have here in Brazil and other countries in the region. So access to tools to smooth consumption, it's not something that's is prevalent in our economy for poor workers. So it's an important question that labor income may change a lot for the same worker across from month to month or across quarters or from year to year. So, and that's special if you're not in the formal sector, right? Or if you transition a lot from the formal to informal sector, as pointed out by Gabriel and Penny this morning, in which we have an economy in which you have firms that hire both informal and formal workers easily. And also, if you look at income volatility, comparing Brazil, for example, and US, right, and look at time series of growth rate, GDP growth rate of Brazil and the US, Brazilian GDP is twice more volatile than the US. Right, we have an informal sector, right? We have a lot of transitions between formal and informal firms or sectors, right? Let me say sectors in the sense that the worker, not necessarily, so the worker will be either under a formal or informal contract. Doesn't matter whether the firm is formal or not here. We also have a very high worker turnover in the formal sector. So the length, the spell of employment is relatively short, even in the formal sector in Brazil. And also we don't have data with very long panel unless you are only considering the formal sector, which is half of the workforce. So we are basically, if you work only with highs, we are missing half of the workforce by doing that. So what we do, basically, is how to understand and try to measure the impact that the informal sector has on labor income volatility. So as I said in the beginning, informality can act as a cushion in the case formal workers are fired, right? So we don't go to zero. You have the chance to work in an informal sector, and that could be an important thing. And that's something that Penny brought this morning. When you have a trade shock, right, an opening of the economy, that could have an impact on how workers transit from formal to informal sectors, but also because of institutions that you have in the region, right? Those transitions and the existence of informal sector may be more frequent than desirable. And that could generate higher volatility if you transit, when you go to the informal sector, it's not a thing that you go once in a lifetime, but if you go like very often, so that would induce also to an increase in your volatility, right? And also the fact that it's more that your labor income in that informal sector, within the informal sector, is more volatile. So which effect dominates, right? Whether that's the cushion effect or the volatility within the informal sector or the in and out of formal to informal, that's something that we try to measure here. Okay, so that's one figure using PNAD. PNAD is, you know, our household survey. And this is using PNAD Continua, which is a panel for five quarters. It's a rotating panel. And what we have here is a measure of volatility, which is basically, I'm going to define exactly what this arc percentage is, but it can be thought as a growth rate between two periods. And here we're taking from the first quarter to the fifth quarter. I'm taking the absolute value of that. So when I take an average, positives and negatives do not cancel out. So you can see that formal workers, they have a lower earnings volatility than informal ones. And here we are defining formal versus informal, those workers given the first quarter when they are interviewed. This employment is just the collection, other papers called non-employment, out of labor force, and unemployment. And basically here you have that volatility, even though they are getting zero earnings, it's because you have that transition from unemployment to either informal or formal. So the thing is that if you look at the green series, is a much higher, almost double of what you see for the formal workers. So they are more, the informal sector is more volatile, earnings there are more volatile than the formal sector. But could that be because they are transiting from one sector to another? So here, what we do, we just look at formal to formal transitions. So that's the pink or red curve, red curve. But we also break down informal to informal, formal informal, and informal to formal. So you see that basically formal to informal or informal to formal, they have the same kind of behavior that when you are only in the informal sector. So the informal sector volatility is producing producing the same amount of volatility when you transit between sectors. And that's going to be important for things that we do next. Okay? So, as I said, there is many studies on dynamics of wages or labor income, right? There is there's literature trying to isolate what is permanent to what is transitory, long literature on that, right? There is also this a more descriptive approach investigating trends in volatility by those papers by Sheen, Solon, and Ziliak, and also Moffitt. There is also some studies in which they look at distribution of changes, right, to see whether changes are more or less widespread, right? So the variance of those changes, it's higher or not, but not only the variance and other higher moments as well. But most of those papers are do not address informal sector or economies in which you have a large informal sector. There are a few papers trying to replicate that literature on transitory and permanent income. So Andrea Portella and co-authors have papers on that. There is one paper by that's Gomez here. That's Gomez, Iachan, and Cesar Santos, in which they look at formal and informal sectors using Pinage continua, first and fifth quarters, to see the distribution, trying to replicate that that part. That literature here that Rowena said, investigating higher moments of distribution of earnings, they do that, separating for formal and informal. And there is this paper by Martinez and Mello trying to measure the impact of trade shocks on earnings risk, right? So there's not much done on this topic for Brazil. So what do you do? So basically, in order to try to construct these long panels, we are going to merge HICE, which has been extensively used, I think. I mean, besides Brenda, all other papers that were presented here used HICE. So myself, I'm also using it. So you already know what it is. But you cannot use HICE to see what happened to the workers after they leave HICE, right? So they either go to unemployment or they go out of the labor force. If they go to an informal job, right, in which you don't have a formal contract, or if you work as a self-employed worker, or if even if you go to domestic paid work, right, in which here in Brazil it has been formalized since 2015. But those people are not at HICE. At the same time, we have Pinage continua, which is this rotating panel that only has first and fifth quarters, so five quarters, right? And we have it covers the entire country, and also informal work and self-employment and so on. Okay, so how can you do that? How can you merge those things? Well, we don't have IDs. Worker IDs of from Pinage continua, unfortunately, so we cannot merge the CPF, which is the identify number, from one survey to administrative data at HICE. HICE covers this long panel since 1980s at least, so in which you can observe the same worker and across time, over time, and also the same firm, so it's really useful to understand how firms set wages. So we cannot merge those data sets in an ideal way. So what we do, right, we basically impute the missing data that you have for those workers who leave HICE using observed characteristics that we observe in both data sets. So what we're going to do is use HICE as the main data for wage dynamics, and then input the missing components, the quarters that we do not observe that worker, right? And also input to which sector that worker would have gone had we had the chance to observe or to merge ideally that. So then, after we construct that, we're going to see whether exiting the formal sector has any impact on labor income volatility when compared before and after the exit. So basically, we are back to a situation as a DFND for an event study in which you can see compared before and after this exit has been the treatment. So you're using data from 2009, 2017, highs. We didn't go too far away in the past because you only have this rotating panel starting in 2012. We had PME, the monthly survey, monthly employment survey that Penny used in her paper, but it only covers metropolitan areas and it's a different structure. But so you're using PNAD continua from 2000. Yeah, I'm gonna tell exactly what you do. From 2012 to 2017. So we observe workers' wage in the formal sector. When that person exits, we have exactly when the person exits, region, gender, race, education, age, wage at exit. And we're also matching on the number of quarters the worker remain out of formal sector. So we have that as well. So we use, because we have five quarters at PNAD, so we're gonna do is, I mean, if someone leaves the formal sector in PNAD, follow that person, and then we see exactly how many quarters that person stayed out of the formal sector, and it's gonna be used to match at highs. And we are not matching, so basically you're also doing, before we do the matching, we have this deterministic matching for length of spell and out of labor, out of formal sector, and before or after 2014. So we're not getting matching someone in the past with current data. So we do this using region, gender, race, education, age, and wage at exit, right, to impute that data. So what we have then, once observations are matched, we have earnings in the quarters out of the formal sector, have the labor market position in those quarters, either a formal, either informal, and informal here, you're gonna put together employed in the employed without a labor contract, that should be better put, self-employed without a registry, and all domestic workers. Formal self-employment, we're gonna put together with employer, and I'm gonna treat them as other, so we're not gonna discuss those people here because that's very small fraction of our sample. And this employment is basically unemployment plus out of the labor force. So because we wanted to have something to present today, we didn't work with the full highs. We randomly select 10% of workers. Otherwise, we'd be running forever in our computers. So we have the sample, the random sample of highs. we are using those five quarters in PNAD continua. Workers are male and female workers from 25 to 44 years old. We split the sample between male and female to see if we got things that would be different, and we didn't get anything that's different, so we are treating male and female workers together. We are only using workers that have an entire employment history. Well, we don't have when they are missing, right, but they are imputing. And we are dropping when the person has more than one job contract in a given month. We're trimming as well for the top distribution, and public servants we are excluding. So basically, we are defining workers in the following way. Formal would be workers that are continuously employed in the formal sector, either in the same firm or switching firms. So, and that's interesting because most of the volatility is not here in this presentation. Most of the volatility in the formal sector, for those who continually stay in the formal sector, comes from switching jobs, right? Someone who stays on the same job. So if you're trying to get an increase, you better get an increase when you change job, right? It's gonna be much harder to get a raise in a salary in the same job. So most of volatility comes from those guys who switch jobs. And within the formal sector, informal, we are defining someone who is informal, or we are imputing that person is informal in at least one of the quarters that we do not observe that person in the highs. And this employment is someone who for all quarters was not in the that we do not observe was not in the informal sector, right? Okay, so that's summary statistics that you probably cannot see, basically showing that formal sectors, well, as you would assume, different than informal one. Let me say that the education, for example, proportion of non-white in the formal sector is smaller than informal. Age distribution is also different, so on and so forth. So let me switch to this measure of volatility, which is basically wage growth, right? But in a way that if you start from zero, that won't be infinite, right? So we are not dividing by zero. You are dividing by this arithmetic mean between your initial position and the last one, okay? So that's, so you have that because you're multiplying by 100, that in that situation, you're gonna have 200, that would be the most, the maximum value of that measure, right? And you're taking average of that for each individual. So that's something that you can construct for each individual and then take an average in a given point of time. So just to compare, not exactly that absolute measure, but without the absolute value, just taking the standard deviation of that measure, when you compare what, it's reported for the US and here, you have double, right? Basically, we have 60 would be double of it's found for US. Okay, so that's the so-called arc percentage change when not have the standard, the absolute value. And that's in this H is basically index how many quarters you're looking at, the distance between those. And I'm gonna focus on four quarters or 1 year. So here is a figure in which you have that measure looking at if you only, the red line is if you do not have any imputation. Basically, you treated your highs data with a missing when you do not observe the person. If you impute zeros, would that be the ball or the green or yellow? I don't know which color is that. And in the middle, you have with imputation. So you can see that, if everyone that left highs went to unemployment, volatility by transition would be higher than what you observe, or given our imputation, assuming that our imputation method is doing a good job. Here is when you split those workers, right? Formal is someone who is always in the formal, informal is someone who left the formal and then got a job in informal sector, at least for one quarter. And this employee is those who, when they left highs, they never got an informal job, right? So basically, you see, it's pretty much stable, right? There's no much happening in the red line. You have a small trend for this employment, meaning that the transition between employment, formal employment to non-employment actually the change in the wages are not that, or change to zero, right, is not that high, right? So basically showing that wages are getting lower, right, in a sense. And informal sector is pretty much stable as well. Okay, so I have three minutes. So let me say what we do in order to try to identify something that would be, well, that could be interpreted as a causal effect, even though we know that could be a difficult thing to do. But let me say that what we have is basically looking at a quarter that someone exists, we're calling that EI. So we're classifying, so we're saying that a cohort is basically when you exit the formal sector. And here is, we are comparing formal with informal. So you see that before someone leaves the formal sector, the volatility measure is basically the same, right? The red and the green are the same. Look at 2010. And then when you go to the informal sector, because wage is gonna be different and we are measuring this growth rate, you're gonna get a higher volatility measure there, right? Remember, we're comparing with four quarters before. And then it goes down, meaning that some of those people are going back to the formal sector, and then it goes up again, but that's a mechanical thing because you're now comparing your formal work, your formal job with the informal one. But then later, it stabilizes at a level that's higher than the previous what you had. So what is driving this higher earnings volatility? Has to do with transition or composition effect. So there is a little bit of both. So here is basically looking at those who just exit once from highs. You see that you come back to the same level of volatility, right? So there is this period in which there is volatility in your labor income that's driven by the fact that you probably get a wage in the informal sector that's different from the formal one. But then it stabilizes when you go back to the formal sector. If you are working in a situation that enters and exits the formal sector many times, that never goes back to the previous level. So that difference that you got here, right, is basically driven by those people who live more than once. And basically, if you compare this thing here, just one, I'm gonna finish. This, this one. Compare this one with this one. Basically giving you, so that's the first exit. So it's basically showing that the wage that you're gonna get at the informal sector when you have this, those multiple exits, right, is much more different than we had in the previous, when you're previously in the formal sector, than those people that just left once. So there might be a composition effect as well. So that's unemployment, I'm gonna jump and go to equations. That's basically the same that Lorenzo showed. And those are the results that you have. So you see that we don't have any effects before the first exit. So people are basically having the same level of volatility. In the formal sector, your wage won't change much, right? But then you see what happens if you are, when you leave, right? Those things here are basically, this is mechanical and mechanical somehow, but then you see that you go back to zero, right, the same level before, after seven quarters. But if you are a multiple exit type person, that never goes back. Now, the point that I said about, because the way that you're looking at four quarters here, mechanically you're comparing either your wage in the formal with the informal, but never at the informal sector, right? So we also did that for one quarter arc, so that H is now one quarter, and you can see something similar. So, which means basically that it's not the wage volatility in the informal sector that's driving that, but those multiple exits and enters in the formal sector. So yeah, that's pretty much that. Thank you.
So we're a little bit out of time, but are there any quick, very quick questions or comments? Yes, Auri.
I was curious. I think you briefly alluded to that, but of course you're looking at not only at those that exit once or multiple times, but there will be differences over time, I presume, if I understood correctly, around the time at which they stay informal or disemployed when they're out of the rise, which may explain why some of these, you know, descriptives, you know, for the disemployed, I remember there was a blue line where the volatility was going down with time,
and
the spikes you got in some of the graphs were also going down in time. Is that what's going on? People are staying less?
When you do the event side, no, because you're controlling for time fixed effects. But you're right that the descriptive reflects what happened during the recession, which is weird, right? Because, I mean, you see that volatility decreasing.
Yeah. It will be interesting to get into what drives the decrease in the volatility, the duration at which people are out of the horizon, and where they're staying. Would be
we're restricting our sample or looking at highs only for those who match exactly what you can observe at PNAD. So those people who stay at most 3/4 away from highs, and then they go back. But you're right, I mean, and they could stay less than you're using that. But the thing is that in this literature, volatility is counter-cyclical, and here is, you're not getting that, as you pointed out. So, yeah.
Any questions? So just a final comment. It would be interesting to see a distinction between informal labor contracts and self-employed, because my guess that self-employed is going to be much more volatile at the bottom of the distribution, right? That's my guess. But I guess this is a very different dynamics in terms of labor market. So if you could break it down, I think it would be nice.
We had that. We didn't find, actually not much difference. And the difference that you got was in the opposite direction. So that's, But I mean, I think it deserves further studies.
Okay. So thank you, Sergio. Thank you to all the speakers for a great session.